Good morning, church. It's great to see everyone in the house of the Lord today. Beautiful weather outside. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. God, you are so good to us. We're so thankful that you have sent your son Jesus to die on the cross to save us from our sins. And right now, Father, I just ask, if there is someone in here that does not have a relationship with you, that you would begin to talk with them. Help them to feel your presence today, to know that you are the one true living God. And for that today, we worship you. So be with Jason as he leads us in music, and Brother Doug as he preaches from your holy word today, and help us to be open and receptive. In Christ's name, amen.
Today is a great day to worship the Lord. Join us as grace leads us and in Christ alone.
In Christ alone, my hope
continue standing as we sing Blessed Assurance, Jesus Is Mine. Oh, right before that, I'm so sorry. Children, first and second grade, you may come down and follow Miss Suzanne to kids' worship. And as they do that, let's sing Blessed Assurance, Jesus Is Mine. Go to the Lord in prayer together. Father, we come before you now. Father, you really are that blessed assurance that you gave your Son to die on the cross for our sins. Father, we are thankful for that sacrifice, and we are here humbly now in this place, in this moment, as you show us why we are here through the songs that we sing, through the prayers, through the scriptures that we read, the leading the Holy Spirit through Brother Doug. Father, we are thankful for this moment now that we can thank you and you alone for everything that you do for us. Be with us as we continue to worship in this moment. In your precious Son's name, amen.
thoughts of my enemy. Though the arrow flies and the terror of night is at my door, I'll trust you, Lord.
And surely goodness.
And surely goodness.
Your holy name,
sure.
Ephesians chapter 5, verses 1 through 7 reads, "Be imitators of God, therefore, as dearly loved children, and live a life of love, just as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us as a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. But among you, there must not be even a hint of sexual immorality or of any kind of impurity or of greed, because these are improper for God's holy people. Nor should there be obscenity, foolish talk, or coarse joking, which are out of place, but rather thanksgiving. For of this you can be sure, no immoral, impure, or greedy person, such a man as an idolater, has any inheritance in the kingdom of God, of Christ. Let no one deceive you with empty words, for because of such things, God's wrath comes on those who are disobedient. Therefore, do not be partners with them."
Good morning, church. If I were to ask you to guess my age, I'm sure that based on the way I look, most of you would say somewhere between the age of 25 and 30. I know this may be hard for you to believe, but I was actually a teenager in the decade of the 70s. Like most high school athletes, I had role models I sought to imitate. As a sophomore quarterback, my role model was Roger Staubach, who played for the Dallas Cowboys and led them to 4 Super Bowl appearances, winning 2 world championships. I played third base in baseball. The major leaguer I sought to imitate was Brooks Robinson, who spent 23 seasons with the Baltimore Orioles. He had such a great glove that he was nicknamed the human vacuum cleaner. My favorite sport was basketball. I played point guard for our team. And as was true of virtually every high school athlete of that era, my role model was Pistol Pete Maravich, who averaged 44.2 points a game during his career at LSU. Well, on Monday of this past week, I did a Google search of the top role models of all time. Listen to these names that appeared in the top 10. The Dalai Lama, Albert Einstein, Marilyn Monroe, Steve Jobs, Amelia Earhart, and Oprah Winfrey. There were no spiritual role models like Billy Graham or Mother Teresa. Neither were there any biblical role models such as Peter or Paul. I can't say that I was shocked, but I was saddened. Before exiting out of Google, I decided to try one more search. This time I typed in the words, "the ultimate role model." To be honest with you, I didn't expect very much. I assumed that the computer would generate the name of some high-tech guru like Bill Gates, or maybe a corporate giant like the founder of Amazon, Jeff Bezos. Maybe it would list a major manufacturer like Elon Musk, the co-founder and CEO of Tesla. But much to my surprise, when I hit enter in my search for the ultimate role model, the result at the top of the page read, "Jesus alone is the ultimate role model because he alone is perfect, never making a mistake and never veering off course, never changing." I tell you, when I read that, I just instinctively cried out, yes, somebody got it right, because Jesus is the ultimate role model. And this is the point that Peter was seeking to make when he penned these words in 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 21. To this you are called, because Christ suffered for you, get this part, leaving you an example that you should follow in his steps. Paul sought to reinforce this same theological truth in today's text, where he wrote this proclamation, be imitators of God. The proclamation found in the opening line of this passage is one we need to both hear and heed. We are to be imitators of God. Last week I shared with you that the Greek term for imitate means to mimic. And the dictionary defines mimic as to take on the appearance of another. The scripture makes it clear that every believer is to be a mimic. The character we've been assigned to mimic is Jesus Christ. In an effort to reinforce this theological truth, Paul, after issuing the proclamation, be imitators of God, went on to provide us with a definitive description of what this looks like. He said, and live a life of love just as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us as a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. Simply stated, the lifestyle Jesus lived is to be the pattern that we are to follow. I pointed out six characteristics of Christ last week. They were, Jesus was passionate, he was positive, he was pure, he was peaceful, he was purposeful, and he was also prayerful. I use the word passionate in reference to love. Jesus was a person who lived a life of love, as Paul pointed out in verse 2. Jesus loved both God and others. And as I was reflecting upon this truth, I was reminded that Jesus did not limit his love just to one particular class of people. Jesus loved everybody. He loved the rich and he loved the poor. He loved people regardless of their age, their age, their gender, their race, or nationality. Jesus loved everyone. And that is the pattern that you and I are to practice. We're to love all people. And we're to love them with the love of God. No exclusions. Jesus was passionate. He was also positive. Jesus said, I'm come that you may have life and have it more abundantly, or have it to the full. On multiple occasions, Jesus told his followers, be of good cheer. People living in the first century AD had a difficult time. They faced some trying circumstances. Things were difficult politically and economically, and yet Jesus said, be of good cheer. I'm telling you, we live in a world that is often negative. And it's easy for us to get down, but with God's help, we don't need to stay down. We need to get up, hold our heads up, and be positive people. We are followers of the Lord Jesus Christ, and while things may be tough now, we know that we win in the end. Amen? And so pick your head up. Don't be so down. Don't be so distraught. Don't be depressed. Just say, I know I'm on the Lord's side, and because of that, I'm on the winning team. The Bible also teaches us that Jesus lived a life of purity. I love this verse. Jesus was tempted in all ways like we are, yet he was without sin. Also, we are reminded of, in Matthew, how Jesus faced those temptations after he'd been fasting in the wilderness. But I'm telling you, those were not the only times Jesus was tempted. He was tempted on multiple occasions. And the Bible says, in all ways like we are, and yet he was without sin. Jesus drew strength from his heavenly Father, and he said no to temptation. And each time in Matthew chapter 4 that Jesus resisted temptation, he quoted scripture. I'm reminded of the Bible verse that says, thy word have I hid my heart, that I may not sin against thee. We need to be people who get the word of God in us so it can come out of us at the appropriate moments of life. May God give you and I the strength we need to say no and to resist temptation so we can be Christ-like in regard to our purity. We also talk about the fact that Jesus was peaceful. Jesus was calm during crises. Jesus did not write the lyrics to the song, I'm All Shook Up. Jesus could sleep in the midst of stressful situations and the storms of life, because he knew his Father was with him. And when he saw his disciples panicking, he said, why are you afraid? Don't you know that I am here? May we listen down through the cards of time and hear the word Jesus spoke to calm the wind and the waves, peace be still. It may be this week that the Lord will be saying that to you. Hey, peace, be still, just chill out. Everything's going to be all right. Jesus was also purposeful. He said, I'm come to seek and to save that which was lost. I know why I'm here. I know why God allowed me to be born, why he sent me here to planet Earth. I'm to seek and to save those who are lost. Our Lord's purpose was not pursuit of possessions or pleasure. He had a spiritual mindset, and he knew there's something more valuable than pleasure and possessions. And then we saw that Jesus was prayerful. I love the verse I shared with you last week, Mark 1:35. Very early in the morning, while it was still dark, Jesus got up, went off to a solitary place, and there he prayed. Can I remind you this morning, if you don't start your day with prayer, you've begun the wrong way. You're already on the wrong road. We need to learn to wake up in the morning and not say, good Lord, it's morning, but good morning, Lord. And I want to talk to you today. I want to hear from you today. And the Bible teaches us, call unto me and I will answer you and show you great mighty things you know not of. May we follow our Lord's example by being prayerful. Our focal text begins with the proclamation of the pattern. Well, this morning, I want us to continue our exploration of this passage by considering the perversion. The perversion. The word perversion comes from a root word perverse, which means to lead away from what is right, natural, and acceptable. To lead away from what is right, natural, and acceptable. Here's what the Lord says is not right, natural, or acceptable in verse 3. But among you, there must not be even a hint of sexual immorality or any kind of impurity or of greed, because these are improper for God's holy people. Paul is making it crystal clear that the things he identified are not right, they're not natural, and they're not acceptable for those who claim the name of Christ. If you say you've been born again, these things should not be a part of your character or your conduct. Paul is saying, if you do these things, you're a pervert. Now, we don't like that. It sounds like such a harsh term to use, but that's exactly what the Word of God is teaching. The Bible is teaching us that the Greek term for sexual immorality refers to all types of sexual sin. And we don't talk a lot about sex in church today, but we should, because the world talks about it all the time. We live in a sexually saturated society. And based on things we see on television and even on the screen at movies, I think today people are not even sure what is right, what is natural, and what is acceptable in the sight of God. So I want to break it down for you with one simple sentence. Sex is a gift of God to be enjoyed only in the context of marriage between a man and a woman. Did y'all get that? Let me say it again because you need to get it. Sex is a gift of God to be enjoyed only in the context of marriage between a man and a woman. Premarital sex is a sin. Extramarital sex is a sin. Sex between people of the same gender is a sin. The sacred scriptures stress this subject over and over and over again. These biblical truths point out another theological truth, and here it is. All sexual sin is sin against God. I want to illustrate this through the life of an Old Testament character with whom you may be familiar. His name is David. David, as you will recall, engaged in the act of adultery with a woman named Bathsheba. Instead of immediately confessing his sin or repenting of that sin, David tried to hide his sin. He tried to cover it up. He even had Bathsheba's husband, Uriah, put to death. But eventually the day came when he was confronted by the prophet Nathan about his sin. And David was so convicted by the Holy Spirit of God that he found himself praying. And this is his prayer. God, against you and you only have I sinned. You say, well, David was married. Didn't he sin against his wife? Well, yeah. Bathsheba was married. Didn't David sin against her husband, Uriah? Yeah. But basically, every sin is a sin against God. And if we could grasp this theological truth, maybe it would help us to decide that I'm going to be more careful about giving in to any type of temptation, because any sin is a sin against God. And it was your sin and my sin that nailed Jesus to the cross on Calvary. And because we've been forgiven of our sin, we should seek to live a life of purity just as Jesus did. And here's what the Bible is teaching us this morning. It is saying these types of activity, sexual immorality, impurity, and greed, they're not right, they're not natural, and they are not acceptable in the sight of God. You say, well, Pastor, I can see that sexual immorality, impurity, but what about greed? Well, greed may be defined as intense, selfish desire. It is putting our desires over the dreams that God has for our lives. He is saying, I'm going to satisfy my appetite regardless of whether it's right in the sight of God. And consequently, when we operate with this type of mentality, we take advantage of others in the process just to get what we want. Greed is a form of idolatry. When we cast God off the throne and put ourselves in a position where we take the wheel and say, I'm going to be the master of my own fate. Let me tell you, when we take the wheel, we become very poor drivers. We endanger ourselves and others by the choices we make. And this is what the Bible says. All this stuff, listen to this, this is the line. It's improper for God's holy people. Did you get that line? It's right here in the text. I'm not making this up. It's right here in the Bible. It says these things are improper for God's holy people. You know what that means? That because we claim the name of Christ, because we are to be little Christ, that's what the word Christian means. We're to be imitators of God. We're to walk in His steps, in the steps of Jesus. We are to be holy. The word holy means to separate or set apart. That's why the Bible says that when we're saved, we're to be different. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has gone, the new has come. Christianity is not something you just add on to your current lifestyle. It is something that radically alters your lifestyle. When all of a sudden I've been going towards sin, I'm turning from sin, I'm turning toward the Savior, and I want to be like Jesus. You say, well, Pastor, I don't hear that a lot in churches today. You probably don't. Because here's what you hear in so many churches today, a message that makes you feel good about yourself, regardless of how you're living. I just want to leave today feeling good about myself. Well, the only way you're going to feel good about yourself is being in right relationship and fellowship with the Father. Think about it. You say, well, no, don't try to rationalize your sin. Don't say, well, I'm better than so-and-so. What I've learned is I'm not better than anybody. I'm just as bad as everybody. And because of that, I need God's forgiveness. I need God's grace. I need His mercy. And I need to be more careful about the way I walk and more careful about the way I talk, because all these things are a form of perversion. They're not right. They're not natural. And they're not accepted in the sight of God. We need to stop trying to impress one another and just get on our face before God and say, God, be merciful unto me, a sinner. I pray you will cleanse me from any perversion that exists in my mind, in my mouth, and in my movements. Help me, God, be pure before you. I asked some people a question the other day. I said, what's your goal in life? And we went around the room and people start telling me their goals. I want to be happy. I want to be a good father. I want to have a great family. I want to be a good provider for my family. They said, well, Pastor Doug, what's your goal? I said, I'm not there yet, but my goal is this. I want my life in these declining years, because I'm not really 20-25, but I want my life to be lived in such a way that I might hear the Father say, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Could that be the goal for your life? That you want to be clean of anything that will prevent you from hearing those words? So that one day you might hear the Father say, well done, thou good and faithful servant. That's a goal for my life, and I pray that it'll be a goal for your life. Another form of perversion that Paul identifies in these verses includes improper forms of speech. Nor should there be obscenity. You can look it up in your Bible. Foolish talk or coarse joking, which are out of place. I want to remind you of something that we've already been exposed to in our study of this biblical book. That is, God is really concerned about the words that come from our mouths. In the previous paragraph, Paul wrote, do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouths, but only which is helpful for building others up. God is concerned about the words we speak. And keep in mind that Paul writes these paragraphs as he's led by the Holy Spirit of God to do so. The seriousness of sin is revealed in Matthew chapter 12, verses 36 and 37, when it comes to what the Bible says and Jesus said about our words. But I tell you that men will have to give an account on the day of judgment for every careless word they have spoken, for by your words you'll be acquitted, and by your words you'll be condemned. That's a sobering passage. You know, within me, I was, well, maybe Jesus was just exaggerating. Surely that can't be true. But I tell you that men will have to give an account on the day of judgment for every careless word they have spoken. Doesn't that make you just want to run down to the store and buy some super glue and put your lips together? How many times this past week did you speak careless words, critical words, cruel words? I'm going to have to get super glue by the 55-gallon drum. How many times did you use profanity? Maybe you hit your thumb with a hammer and you call that hammer a dirty word. Did you tell any dirty jokes last week? Listen to what the Scripture says about this subject. The Bible says, these things are out of place. They should not be a part of our conversation. Fourth word I would call your attention, a fourth point from this passage, is the punishment. The punishment. Now listen to what the Scripture says, verse 5. For of this you can be sure. A literal translation from the Greek might read, you already know this. No immoral, impure, or greedy person, such a man is an idolater, has any inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and of God. The Scripture is very clear. Those who habitually engage in this type of lifestyle will have no part in the kingdom of God. We should not try to console ourselves or others by saying, well, you know, we all just make mistakes. Once saved, always saved. If this type of lifestyle becomes a pattern, you're listening to me? If this type of lifestyle becomes a pattern we perpetually practice, there's a good probability. I didn't say possibility. I said there's a good probability we've never been truly born again. Because our lifestyle and our language should reflect the fact that we have been saved, that we've been born again into God's family, and because of that, we are new creatures. The old things have now passed away. This may be how we used to live, but it's not how we still live. That doesn't mean you're not going to trip up from time to time, but it does mean that when you trip up, you're going to confess up and get back in right fellowship with the Father. There's punishment because we're not going to inherit the kingdom of God. And that should be something that causes us to pause for perspective, to look at our lives and ask ourselves a question: have I truly been saved? Have I been redeemed? And where is the evidence to support that fact? The Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 9 and 10, do you not know that the wicked will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived, neither the sexually immoral, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor male prostitutes, nor homosexual offenders, nor thieves, nor the greedy, nor drunkards, nor slanderers, nor swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God. Two weeks ago, I was meeting with a group of people, and the subject of eternity came up. People began to express their beliefs, and inevitably the question came around, well, Pastor Doug, what do you believe about this? I was quick to inform them that I believe that every person will live forever. It's just a matter of our destination, where we're going to spend eternity. I believe the Bible clearly teaches there's a place called heaven. I believe the Bible clearly teaches there's a place called hell. And if those two places exist, I will always want to choose heaven over hell. Amen? And so if you want to go to heaven, I told the group, you need to know how to get there. And I'm not going to tell you what I think. I'm going to tell you what Jesus said. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. And so I believe that people who have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ are going to heaven, and people who have rejected Jesus will spend eternity in hell, and that's not a part of God's plan for your life, but I believe that's what the Bible teaches. And there's a man to my right who said, I'd like to say something. I said, okay, go ahead. He said, I just don't believe like you believe. I believe if there is a heaven, God's going to let everybody in. I said, sir, you're free to believe whatever you choose to believe. But just know, there are consequences for our choices. And if you choose to believe that, you better hope you're right and the Bible, not me, but the Bible is wrong. And you need to have a basis for what you believe. Every one of us need to have a basis for what we believe. And it shouldn't just be, well, my grandma and grandpa said that. If they gave you the right beliefs, that's good. Not just because your mom and daddy said that. If they gave you the right beliefs, that's good. But you need to have a basis for your beliefs. And the basis for my belief is the Word of God. What does the Bible teach? The Bible is a firm foundation. Jesus said, everyone who hears these sayings of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise man who built his house on the rock. And the rain came down, and the storms blew, and the rain, the water rose, and the house did not fall because it's found on the rock. But everyone who hears these sayings of mine and does not put them into practice is like a what? A foolish man who built his house on the sand. And that same rain came down, and the waters rose up, and the winds blew and beat upon that house, and it fell with a great crash because it had been founded on the sand. You need to check your foundation, why you believe what you believe. And if you don't believe like the Bible believes, you need to change your beliefs. Don't try to make the Bible correspond to what you want it to say. You make sure your lifestyle corresponds with what the Bible clearly teaches. Otherwise, there is a punishment that you can't afford to experience. Our text makes it clear that those who do such things will not have any inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and of God. I don't think the Bible can make it any more clear. Don't find somebody who will just comfort you. You better listen to somebody who, by the power of God, will convict you of your need to get out of sin and into the Savior. There's a final point that I want to call to your attention for this passage. That is the prohibition. The prohibition. Verses 6 and 7. Let no one deceive you with empty words, for because of such things, God's wrath comes on those who are disobedient. Listen to verse 7. Therefore, do not be partners with them. The prohibition, don't be partners with them. Friend, you better check out those people with whom you share close associations. Here's what Paul wrote in another passage. Do not be misled. Bad company corrupts good character. Perhaps you've seen the commercial on television. There's a young man sitting there with his dog. It's a long-haired dog, and the boy is long-haired, and they just look a lot alike. I don't know who looks like who, whether the guy looks like the dog or the dog looks like him. But they just are best friends, and so they look like one another. Let me tell you, you can't hang out with the wrong crowd without it having a detrimental impact on your life. You hear what I'm saying? You can't do it. You're going to be surprised one day if you hang around and have close companions who are always cursing and using that vile language and obscenities we heard about a minute ago, you're going to surprise yourself one day when something goes wrong and something comes out of your mouth. Do y'all hear what I'm saying? If you hang around with people who party all the time, chances are you're going to start partying too. I used to share this in my testimony. There's a time in my adolescent years that I started hanging out with the wrong crowd. And it wasn't long until I became the wrong crowd. Now, don't y'all look at me like that. A lot of you have the same testimony. And Paul is just saying, and I could give you scripture after scripture, I've got them listed, about people we need to withdraw fellowship from because of the detrimental impact they may have upon our lives. You remember Flip Wilson, the comedian? He used to always say, the devil made me do it. And you can say, well, my friends made me do it. No, they didn't. You're responsible for your own choices. And you're responsible for choosing your own companions. And the Bible makes it clear, therefore, do not be partners with them. The Bible says, do not be unequally yoked together with unbelievers. You want to see a messy marriage? You look at somebody who's a Christian who marries a non-Christian. They're not pulling in the same direction. They're unequally yoked. I'm not saying that if you're a Christian, you're better than somebody who's lost. Remember what I said earlier, we're just as bad as everybody else. But it means I've got to protect my character, not just my reputation, but my character. Not just what others think about me, but what God knows about me. I hope some of you are picking up what I'm laying down this morning. It's a big deal. I think probably a lot of the parents here today who have teenagers are saying, I'm glad you got that point because I don't want my kids hanging out wrong folks. Well, mom and dad, it's just as applicable for you and me as it is for them. We need to share Christ with those people. We need to love on those people. But we don't need to live with those people every day. We've been looking at some powerful passages from the book of Ephesians. We're to be mimics of the Messiah. We're to be like Jesus. And Jesus cared about those who were lost. Jesus went to the house of Zacchaeus, but he didn't move in. Jesus met with a woman at the well who'd been married multiple times, but he did not engage in an improper relationship with her. On and on, the biblical record reveals that Jesus loved those who are lost, but he did not live with those who are lost or live like those who are lost. If we want to reclaim our witness that maybe has been diluted by our lifestyle, we need to bow before the Father today in a spirit of confession and repentance, saying, God, be merciful unto me, a sinner. I've made some poor choices. But the good news is, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us of all our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. It's the blood of Jesus that can do that. And that's what Jesus wants to do for you today, if you'll come to him. Would you bow with me, please? Heads are bowed and eyes are closed. I want to ask you just to look at your own life and your lifestyle. If you were to slip out to eternity today, would you hear the Father say, well done, thou good and faithful servant? Or would there be some things in your life that you need to confess and repent of this morning? I pray that you'll be open and obedient to the leadership of the Lord. Father, I pray that you would speak now in the stillness of this moment. Give us conviction. Challenge us. Challenge us to be mimics of the Messiah. It's my prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
What a wonderful hymn as we close this morning. If you feel Jesus tugging at your heart, I'll be sitting down here at the front at the end of the service if you would like to make Jesus Christ your personal Lord and Savior. If you'd like to know more about First Baptist Church, I'll be down here at the front as well to answer any questions you have about joining our fellowship. Don't forget the offering as you leave this morning. Don't forget life groups also at 9 a.m. I'm glad that some of you set your clocks back, or you might would have made it to life group this morning. So we want you to be a part of life group. If you have any questions about that, again, I'll be down at the front to answer any of those questions. And today is Brother Doug. They are on the spot today. Today is Dollar Day. So if you get those dollars ready and look for the blue buckets as you exit this morning. Jason?
Let's stand together as we end, as we sing a chorus of Victory in Jesus.
Oh,